It started approximately 5 o'clock in the afternoon. I was on my company in the city of Placentia, and the fire, we were listening to it over the radio, and sounded like it was bumping up against some homes. And so they started launching resources pretty quickly. So we got dispatched to the fire to a strike team assignment.
So we worked the entire night, and it was an exhausting night. That morning, it started right up. And that afternoon, we were along the 261 toll road mopping up, and there was some fire that was creeping up along Santiago Canyon Road, and resources were thin there. Most of our resources were in the Portola and Foothill Ranch area, and we were sent that way, and it was basically our strike team was asked to go help out a different division.
So as we moved up the road here towards the location where we ultimately deployed our shelter, we came across two hand crews doing a burnout operation. They were trying to burn the eucalyptus away from the road. There's a community behind us that is homes that are in the interface. It's a box end canyon. There's probably 2,000 residents in there. So the priority was keep the fire on that side of the road so it doesn't impact that community.
And so we were staged in different areas, and the fire, we noticed it. The wind was in our favor. It was blowing down the fire, and it was a pretty long fire front too. It got into some of these eucalyptus trees, and we were watching. The fire was going straight up, the wind was in our favor, and then all of a sudden we saw the wind shift and it spotted over.
So we immediately notified everybody, hey, we've got a spot fire burning on the other side of the road, and we went to work, started to pull off of our engine a 200-foot pre-connect. Within a few minutes, we had another two or three other engines with their crews coming to help support the hose line. As we immediately got our hose line off the engine and we just started to get water going, we hadn't even attacked the spot yet. We were still probably 25, 30 feet from the spot. Our hose blew. As soon as we got near the fire, one of the guys hadn't put a wet line down enough, and we blew another hose, which allowed the fire to move a little farther up the hill and get a little bigger and got a little more of a jump on us. So with that, we replaced that hose line and went up, and now the fire had grown pretty good. Now, since we had a little bit of wind influencing the fire, and it was still moving up the hill, we still felt like we had a pretty solid anchor. We had a pretty good black area that we could work from as we were moving up the hill. We'd also had one of the other engines down below pull an exposure line.
And it looked like an easy reach with the deck gun. We put water on it. We were that much short of hitting it, and I could see all the water running off the hill. I instructed my guys to gear up, tool up. We were going to go on the hill and help Mitch out the rest of the way.
I had a conversation with Doug Dodge. He was basically going to be at the back of the hose lay as a lookout. I was going to be in the middle, and Mitch was in the front of the hose lay. So we were spread out, the three captains with our crews, and we were just trying to improve that line, trying to progress, and that fire was just getting bigger and bigger.
So I continued following the hose line up the hill. I got to the top, and there was a cluster of guys there with Mitch and the three reserves from Station 14. Everybody was kind of bunched up. I was looking at the hose. It was on the ground. It was kind of a spaghetti mess. They had had some additional broken hose lines, and Mitch was sorting it out. It's about that time that the ground, people that were on the ground, started notifying us that a spot had started underneath us in the ravine. About that time, they had sorted out the hose. They were starting to flow water. I turned around and watched the fire burn through our hose line. And I saw it, turned quickly enough to see whoever was on the nozzle, I can't remember at the time, watch it just go bloop. And I went, we got problems. I could hear them doing horn blasts. The engineer on 22 that was working for Mitch was doing the horn blasts, emergency horn blasts. The hand crew, I could hear them pretty clearly from the road yelling at us, come down, come down. There was so much fire on the little goat trail that we came up, I said, there's absolutely no way we're going back down that way.
Doug Dodge, one of the other captains, came up to me and informed me that we had multiple spot fires below and that our route back down for escape, which I felt was our solid anchor point had been lost, and they weren't able to control the spot fires below. So we moved up the hill, still felt pretty comfortable that we were okay. We still had a area with some green that I felt if we had to, we could come back down and get back down to the road on that side. And as I looked, we started to have a spot fire in front of us. We then all of a sudden looked, and now our only avenue, I felt, was to go over to the side.
And we were kind of up against the cut bank, and Mitch said, I think we can go out to the other end here. We can go through the green. And I said, okay. And he kind of left to go take a recon of that. I was kind of getting everything sorted, kind of getting bearings. I'm looking down the cliff face, and I could see fire on that. I told the firefighters that were close to me to drop their packs and start raking it out, take their hand tools and making the area bigger. I kind of, I guess in my mind, already knew that we were going to stay where we were at. Whether we got in the shelters or not, I knew we had nowhere to go. Mitch had chased the spot up to the hill, so the spot had kind of grown and burned off the top of the hill already. I didn't burn it completely, it just burned off the grass, got it enough where it was charred and the rocks were hot. But there was manzanitas around us that was starting to light off. Mitch came back and said, you know, we got fire behind us, but I think we can go that way, or maybe we can go off the cliff edge. And well, and then I said, we're not going down that cliff edge. First off, I had put water on it with the monitor, so I knew how steep it was. Mitch and I both kind of said, well, we've got a lot of people. I go, somebody's going to get hurt if we go down that way. And I go, are we going to be able to get 12 people out that other way? Or if it was you and me, I'm good to go, but there's a lot of people to move. I think we're going to have to deploy. It seems like a long time, but I know these decisions were happening fairly quickly. And another company officer was standing next to us, and I think when I said the word, we're going to have to deploy, some of the firefighters kind of clicked into that, and I could see them start coming out of the cases. And so the decision kind of got made. And we said, yeah, we're deploying.
At first, still didn't really believe it. I still thought there's got to be other options. We're, you know, right next to the road. We're not that far into the green. There's got to be another avenue to go down. I walked the perimeter, looked at him, and we both came up with the decision. There was nothing else we could do.
And I remember one of the guys right off the bat said, let's make a run for it. And myself and a number of other guys said, no way, we're staying right here. There was nowhere to run. You were all trying to just, you know, within seconds to come up with another plan, and there was no other plan. And the best thing we did was get into our shelters.
And problem was, we were starting to get some really big flame lengths that were starting to impinge. So we started to move closer towards the cliffside. We had everybody accounted for. And so basically the guys did a semicircle, feet facing towards the fire. Each company officer laid down as close as he could with his crew. The deployment itself went smooth. The hardest part was you could see that some of the guys were really, really nervous. And I felt pretty comfortable that we had a large black area. We had enough distance between the fuel that we were going to be okay. But if we didn't deploy, that some guys were going to suffer some burns. And but the big thing was a couple of the guys, you know, calmed the guys down, said, hey, look, you guys, we've got a good black area. We've got a lot of crews down below. You know, we have helicopters, we have things that are going to come help us, but for the next few minutes, we're going to have to sit tight and wait for basically help to arrive.
So, and that then once you know that that's pretty much inevitable, you start going through your training, at least I do, thinking about what I've been taught regarding fire shelter deployment, and what to do to prepare the area that you're in, and then what to do to deploy that shelter. And so when they said, okay, we're going to deploy, start looking for an area to deploy your shelter, I look around and it was all black for the most part. I mean, there were still some stumps and some big twigs that were sticking out of the ground and a lot of rock, but there wasn't really a lot of fuel that I could see that was going to burn if I put my shelter down on top of it. But in any case, I still cleared away as much as I could and then moved away the rocks. So I, you know, threw a couple of those down the hill, as a few other people did, and then we got the order to deploy. So it was pretty much just like you train. Just pulled it out of the pouch, and for me, it performed exactly as I expected it to. But I remember keeping a firm hold on it, and then just like they taught us, kind of got inside of it, dropped to my knees, made sure that everything was inside, held it down with kind of like my lower legs and my forearms, and just got all situated, made sure that, you know, nobody else was right on top of us. I know there were a lot of us in a I guess it was big enough for all of us, but it was still kind of a small area. So I remember people kind of brushing or laying up against you, and you'd say, hey, you know, can you scoot that way a little bit? Hey, I'll scoot this way.
The ground had burned clean, and it was a clean burn through there. And so, but just instinct, those shelters came out good with good training. I loved having the handles. It made it a lot easier, but it still, it took a little bit to get it out. So for that split second, it's like, come on, come on, come on. And then the shelter came out.
I got down on the ground and remember taking a look around. Mitch were and I were next to each other, kind of face to face, and went underneath the shelter. I was kind of in a, I had my legs pulled up to my chest. I didn't have enough room to spread out and put my arms and hold all the corners down. And I was kind of laying on my side. So it was a little bit uncomfortable.
So once we got inside the shelters, we designated one person to be the communication with the strike team leader to let him know, you know, our status and what was going on, and that ended up being me. So the big thing was obviously we let him know, hey, we're deploying shelters, everybody's okay, everybody's accounted for. We did have a little bit of communication problems with the radio inside the shelter. I ended up having to take my radio and slide the antenna outside of the shelter to get pretty clear communication. We let him know, look, we're laying down right now. Everything's good. It was pretty hot inside the shelters, A, due to the fact that the area we were in had just burned. There was a lot of cobblestone in the area too, so we were laying on a lot of hot rocks, which added to the heat in the shelter. There was a few snags and some things laying on the ground that were still burning, so some of the guys had pretty good smoke in their shelter. And as it started to go on in duration as far as being in the shelter, the heat did increase from the east side with all the fuel that we had burning. And you could hear it burning and cracking.
I hadn't expected to deploy a fire shelter in the black in an area that had just burned. And so I'd say that there were some factors involved with that that I hadn't necessarily anticipated. One of them was, I'd say the biggest one, was the heat of the ground. I hadn't expected the ground to be so hot when we, you know, decided to lay down on top of it. And so my knees, pretty much from my knees down and my elbows through my forearms were hot. And anything that had like a button or a zipper, anything that was metal, anything that was close to the ground was hot. And so that was made the biggest, you know, impression in my mind was how hot it was inside and how hot the ground was. And so I was sort of like a lizard on a hot rock, you know, just trying to push myself off and have as much or as little of my body touching the ground as possible. But you can only do that for so long because I forget exactly how long we were in there, but it was definitely longer than I could keep my body off the ground. So there was that aspect that was a little uncomfortable, but it wasn't unbearable. Of course, you know, I'm not going to get out. As much as I want to, I'm not going to get out. So we just kind of had to put up with that. Second was the smokiness inside the shelter. Because everything had just burned, there were little stumps and twigs and, you know, everything that was smoking inside the shelter and filling the shelter up with smoke. And that was another instance where I thought, well, I could just, you know, lift the corner of the shelter and maybe get some fresh air, but I couldn't see. I didn't want to check the conditions on my own. I'm not claustrophobic at all, but I definitely remember thinking, this is uncomfortable. I don't like this at all. I want to be out of here. But again, you just revert back to the training and they tell you, you know, resist all urges to get out of your fire shelter.
So we sat tight, let the strike team leader know that we weren't going to do anything until we were given the sign that it was all clear. I communicated with him, hey, how's it looking over our head? Do we still have a lot of fire up above us or around us? And he said, yeah, you know, sit tight. You still have got a lot of fire. And I said, look, we're not going to move until you tell us it's safe to come out of the shelters. So we sat for about 15 minutes inside the shelter. At about 12 minutes, we heard one of our helicopters coming, and we heard the water drop right next to us. Immediately, could feel everything cool down considerably with that first water drop. Then we could hear the chainsaws down below with the hand crew there firing up chainsaws to cut a line to come in to where we were. That was reassuring knowing that, you know, they were coming up, those sounds. And then the other fact, we had a second water drop. And with that, the strike team leader said, hey, you know, you're clear. Mitch, have one guy come out of his shelter and take a look around. I got up, took a look around, saw that we were okay. And just about that time, guys started to come out of their shelter. We had a hand crew coming up the hill. And that was pretty much the end of it. All the guys came out. No injuries, no one even had any cuts or scrapes. And we were taken down from there off the hill onto the roadside where they did an evaluation. They had the medics come look at us. They then took us by ambulance to our headquarters just to evaluate us and do a debriefing. After the debriefing, we were taken to a hotel for the night, and then the next morning we were back on the fire line.